Good evening to each of you. It's good to see each of you. And we've had a good day. It's always great when we feel like we're family and we get together on Sunday, even twice. And I'm glad you're part of us and that I get to be part of you. We're going to open our service with a word of prayer. I'm going to ask Brother Isaac Romans if he would come at this time and lead us in our opening prayer. God bless him.
Father God, thank you for a place to gather in your name, for a church family that loves each other. Be with us, dear Father. This world's getting worse and worse. I pray that we will lean on you through the hard times and the good times, dear Lord. Bless the service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Songbook, if you'd like this evening, and turn with me to hymn number 255. It's Holy Week, so we're going to sing about the sacrifice, the cross, and the transformation that takes place in a life that has entrusted itself to those things. Let's enter into a spirit of worship tonight with humble and grateful hearts. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing 255. There is a fountain.
Fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all. Fountain in his day, and there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. I wash all my sins away, wash all my sins away, and there may I, though wash all my sins away. Dear dying Lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved. Sin no more, be saved to sin no more, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Ever since by faith I saw the stream, thy flowing wounds supply. Redeeming love has been my theme, and it shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. This redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die. When this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave. Then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save. Oh yes, I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save. Then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save.
We're going to keep the music a little peppy for one more hymn, so I think you can remain standing. If you'd like to sit, you're welcome to, though. This song lends itself to being sung with a pep in your step and a tap in your toe. So let's do that in a spirit of worship tonight, all right? 251, my sins are covered by the blood. And if you were a Nazarene from Canada, you might even clap a little bit on this song. It may stick, you never know.
Once in sin's darkest night, I was wandering alone. A stranger to mercy I stood. But the Savior came nigh when he heard my faint cry. And he put my sins under the blood.
There you go.
And they are covered by the blood. They are covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood. Mine iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood. From the burden I carried, now I am set free. For Jesus has lifted my load. Oh, the love and the grace I received in its place when he put my sins under the blood. And they are covered by the blood. They are covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood. Mine iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood. I can never understand why he sought even me, why his life's blood on Calvary flowed. But sufficient for me, since he died on the tree, he has put my sins under the blood. They are covered by the blood. They are covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood. Mine iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood. Now he comes to my heart, removes every care. He bears all my cumbering load. In a pathway replete with his love are my feet, since he put my sins under the blood. They are covered by the blood. They are covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood. Mine iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood.
Try singing the chorus this way.
They're still covered by the blood. They're still covered by the blood. My sins are still covered by the blood. Mine iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are still covered by the blood.
Can you say praise God? Praise God. Amen. If you're thankful, you can be seated tonight. I'm thankful tonight that we know exactly what blood we're talking about. It's the blood of Jesus. But you know, if somebody were to come in off the street and walk into our service and sit on the back row and not have any kind of church upbringing, they might be a little bit weirded out. What's this blood and why is it covering everything? But we know. and we're thankful. And we bless the name of the Lord, who had a heart for his people that he had created, who loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son, so that some of the world might find salvation. Oh, that's not quite right, is it? So that all might have opportunity to be fulfilled into a rightly renewed relationship with God the Father through the sacrifice of Christ, which was designed by a heavenly Father with his people in mind. God knows your name, and he holds you very close to his heart. Not only as Brother Bob preached this morning, did Jesus make the eternal salvation decision for us, we too need to come to the point where we make the eternal salvation decision for ourselves. Am I going to trust Jesus? Am I going to surrender my life? Am I going to fill out that blank page and write "Dear Lord" at the top and just sign my name at the bottom and let him fill in the scribbles and scratches in between? Are you willing to give him everything? If you have, and if you are tonight, you start a whole new walk, don't you? He says he makes all things new. And I believe the life that we live in Christ Jesus is lived within the shadow of the cross. This hymn is entitled, "Near the Cross." In my life, Lord, keep me near the cross. Keep the sacrifice of Jesus on the forefront of my mind. Don't let me get distracted. Don't let me sway too much to the left or too much to the right. Keep me in the center of the road where I live, right in the shadow of that tall beam that stems the cross. Let me live in the influence of the Holy Spirit. Let me live with the sacrifice of Christ always in mind. Let's sing number 240 together. And let's ponder the sacrifice tonight and ponder the life that we live in Christ.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There the bright and morning
Service probably wouldn't be complete in the theme of the cross without singing hymn number 233. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For it was on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So, or therefore, or in light of that, I will cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies I lay down, or as the last song said, till I reach the golden strand. I will cling to the old rugged cross, live in its shadow, right, and exchange it someday for a crown. What a trade. And then I believe we take those crowns and we cast them at Jesus' feet, with hearts of gratitude and worship and praise that will be celestial in that place that has no end. Let's sing this favorite.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling at last I lay down. Oh, I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For it was on that old cross that Jesus suffered and died to pardon and
Cling to it. What does that mean? Hold tightly. You know, there's some people who hold tightly onto the little crosses they hold around their necks. Some people hold tightly to the little rosaries that they carry around in their pockets and count the beads. I'm thankful that the thing we have to hold tightly to is not actually something that is tangible. Because if it was tangible, we might lose it. Ever lost your keys? Ever lost a credit card? We hold on to it, we live our lives in light of it, and we anticipate the coming of Christ again. That's how much, and that's how we hold on to the cross of Christ. Praise the Lord. Vicki, I'm wondering if you would come and lead the congregation in prayer tonight. There are many needs represented among us. Many are experiencing surgeries. I know while I was away, there was quite a few that Pastor Mike attended to, and there's more coming in the weeks ahead. Brenda Ganstein, I believe, has a broken arm right now. Let's continue to pray for Deborah Montgomery, Katie's grandmother, whose condition has not gotten any better throughout the day. There's other needs that you're aware of as well. So let's take them to a Heavenly Father who hears us and cares about us. Let's stand together. Vicki, come lead us in prayer tonight.
Our dear precious Lord, I am so thankful tonight for your presence. I'm thankful for the love that you give us, Lord. Oh, we don't deserve it, but Lord, I'm thankful for it. I ask you tonight to bless, continue to bless in the service in a mighty way. Bless Pastor Rick as he leads and gives us the message, Lord. Father, there are so many, Lord, that are ill or hurting. And Lord, we ask that you would just touch them, Lord. Please touch Brenda in a mighty way and heal her arm, Lord, and give doctors wisdom and show them what to do. And Katie's grandma, Lord, Father, we know that you know all about it, and we ask you to take care of it. Heavenly Father, we can't remember the rest, but you know who they are, and we ask that you would move in their situations in a mighty way. Help us, Lord, each and every one, to do what you would have us to do and to be what you want us to be, precious Lord. We love you, Father, so much, and we know that you are able, and we ask all things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. don't know the story of how I made it through. When trouble, pain and fear. The answer may sound simple, though everything else crumbles. One thing has remained through all the years. I still serve an amazing God. He's been with me every mile, my weary feet have trod. He still cares, he still hears, he's still mending broken hearts and drying tears. This old world is bound to change, but I'm glad I know the one who always stays the same. And my song will ever be, amazing God, you're still amazing me.
The God who parted the waters still makes a way today. He's always brought me through the troubled sea. The one who fed the thousands, whose words can calm the tempest. He's my bread of life, and he's my peace. I still serve an amazing God. He's been with me every mile, my weary feet have trod. He still cares, he still hears, he's still mending broken hearts and drying tears. This old world is bound to change, but I'm glad I know the one who always stays the same. And my song will ever be, amazing God, you're still amazing me. I still serve an amazing God. He's been with me every mile, my weary feet have trod. He still cares, he still hears, he's still mending broken hearts and drying tears. This old world is bound to change, but I'm glad I know the one who always stays the same. And my song will ever be, amazing God, you're still amazing.
I love it when you can feel
the presence of God's Holy Spirit. And you don't feel that everywhere you go. But when you come into God's house and you meet with God's people and they have their mind upon the Lord, there is such a presence. And I just praise God. He has ministered to my spirit today several times. And it's both been here, not that he hasn't at other places, but the service this morning, Pastor Bob gave a good message, spoke to our hearts, gave us a challenge, and it's up to us to decide whether we will accept that challenge or not. And I'm glad that I accepted that challenge a long time ago. Matter of fact, I'm so old I don't even remember it. I just praise the Lord for how he's been faithful through my life to get me to this point tonight. I love him so very much. And if you love him, then serve him. Honor him. Lift him up within your life. He has so much that he wants to do for you. This evening, I would like to put Romans 12 that I've been looking at out of the picture for a little bit and center more upon this time of year for the church. And as Pastor Tim mentioned, this is Palm Sunday. Without being in, excuse me, someone used to say, my adolescence is showing. Without being in the pastorate, these things come up too fast. In the pastorate, you're preparing your schedule and the church schedule and the church and everything, and you know when things are coming. Palm Sunday caught me off guard. I know it's different depending upon when April is, yeah. I know it's different depending upon when Easter is. Sometimes it's in March, sometimes it's in April. But this time it just seemed to catch up to me. And I really appreciate this time of year. I hope you do too. I hope you spend time with the Lord in his word. And read those issues in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Look at the events of this week and allow them to soak into your mind and your spirit. God has given us his word that we may glean from it his goodness, his mercy, his glory, his grace, and his direction. Stay in the word. I had an issue, and I was talking with my wife about this a little bit earlier. I wear compression socks. I have a bad vein in one of my legs, and so I wear compression socks. When I wear compression socks, and it seems to be on these pants more than any, it's like the electricity catches, and they come up like that. And if you see that happening, one day after service, Marie Pierre was walking down the aisle. I was walking back, and I thought she was going to bow down in front of me, and I thought, no, don't do that. And she bent over, and she got my pants leg and straightened it. And I was so thankful that she did that for me because it really looks weird. So if by the time I'm done, the pants legs are halfway up my leg, it's all right. There's nothing that's alive down there other than my legs, and we will make it through. We have in Matthew chapter 21, and I want us to go there if you would in your Bibles, please. In verses 1 to 11, we also have in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Luke chapter 19, verses 28 through 44. And John chapter 12, verses 12 through 19. The accounts of the triumphal entry of Jesus into the city. But tonight I want us to look in Matthew chapter 21. We're going to begin with verse 1. And if you would stand with me, please, to honor the word. As Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethphage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them on ahead. "Go into the village over there," he said. "As soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there with its colt beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks what you are doing, just say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will immediately let you take them." This took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, "Tell the people of Jerusalem, 'Look, your king is coming to you. He is humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt.'" The two disciples did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the colt to him and threw their garments over the colt, and he sat on it. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, "Praise God for the Son of David! Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in highest heaven." The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered. "Who is this?" they asked. And the crowds replied, "It's Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Thank you. You may be seated. This event fulfilled the prophecy from Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. And we read what that prophecy was. The people were shouting and praising God. They were giving all sorts of adulations and praises. Some were placing palm branches in front of the donkey. Some were throwing their cloaks in front of the animal so that they would be able to honor the one who was riding into the city on that animal. Songs were being sung. Shouts were being heard. Declarations of political royalty were even given. "Hail the King of Israel." Wow. What an entrance. But let's look at it from a little bit different perspective for a few minutes. With all this cheering, singing, praising, and idolizing, the people did not know what was going to happen. They had preconceived ideas of what was going to happen. They thought they knew what he was going to do. They wanted a military leader. They wanted all the enemies of Israel to be put down. They wanted to overcome all the adversities that they were facing. "He's going to lead us militarily, and he's going to be a conquering hero. He's going to be able to solve the financial problems of the nation." They had preconceived ideas. I mean, after all, Jesus had healed the sick. He had restored sight to the blind. He had given balance and uprightness to the lame that they would be able to walk again. He could do all these things, And they thought he could do anything. And they were right. He could do anything. And he did. But not in the way they expected. They thought he would put down the enemy, and they saw the enemy in the form of people. Jesus was more concerned about another enemy. This enemy was not as powerful as Jesus. He wasn't concerned about him because he was so powerful that he would be a rival to Jesus. He was an enemy because he knew, Jesus knew what he could do to stop, to cause doubt, and to eradicate faith in the followers of our Lord. It was happening throughout the nation. Religious and political leaders were not following God's word. They were going through rituals and rites, but there was no heart relationship like there should have been. The enemy Jesus was talking about or thinking about was that of Satan. Satan, the name, is derived from a Hebrew verb meaning opposer or an obstructor. He tries to oppose and obstruct anything we do for the glory of the Lord. Anything. He even makes sure that mama's time with little children do not include a chance to tell them about Jesus and his word. He'll busy up the day. He'll do anything he can to distract. He's also known as one who is an accuser. He accuses us of our past sins. He makes us feel guilty where we have failed to serve the Lord. He brings doubts into our minds and says, "You're just not good enough. If you were good enough, you would have." He will oppose, obstruct, accuse, and do anything he can to get our minds off of Jesus, onto ourselves, and onto sin. How often in the past have you wondered if God was really there? You go through some hard times, tough times, and it seems like you're praying and you say, "Lord, I'm not getting anywhere. I'm not getting answers. What's happening? Are you really there? Are you hearing me? Have I done something wrong? Why aren't you responding?" Some of us wonder, "God, if you're there, why don't you change things? Why don't you change people's hearts? You could make them good." But that's not love, is it? Love is something we willingly give. And the nation of Israel was told, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart." Oh dear, it's a lot easier to love the Lord with our deeds than our hearts. A deed is something we can do, and we can carry it out, and we can know when we accomplish it. But to love the Lord with all of our heart? That's what Pastor Bob was talking about today. Giving him our undivided, complete heart. Remember, I said the people praising Jesus as he entered the city did not know what was coming. And they certainly didn't. They did not know how he would work on their behalf or if he would even work on behalf of the people. They did not know if they were going to come into financial need. You know, if we have financial needs, we pray and ask God, and we say, Lord, I have this need, and if you don't mind, if you would meet this financial need, you don't have to give me extra, just give me what I need, and I'll be happy. We have preconceived ideas, don't we? That God's going to be our servant. We pray expecting God to respond to us. And we think we deserve it because we have declared an allegiance or a loyalty to him. So, Lord, do your work. Meet my need. He doesn't work according to our wants and wishes, but he does work in ways that are best for us and that will grow us strong within our spirits. We do not know what he will do or how he will do it. That is why we need to keep our eyes upon Jesus. In our last pastorate, we had a group that was going to take a mission trip to Haiti. And I was planning on going with them. And a few weeks before the trip was to come about, I started to get a twinge right up here. And I thought, you know, I probably need to go get that checked out before I leave for the trip. I don't want to be down in Haiti and have a problem and not get the medical attention that they might have here that would take care of it a little bit better. So I went to the doctor, and he was telling me to take deep breaths, and he was checking out with that cold stethoscope and tapping on the back, tapping on the chest. And he said, I'll be right back. And I said, okay. And I started to put my shirt back on. I was getting ready to go home. And I had driven down to the doctor's office. Mary was gone and had the other car. And so I didn't see that there was a problem. And a few minutes later, he came back in and he said, now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go get a stress test. I said, okay. I said, does it matter when I get it scheduled, how quickly? He said, well, fairly quickly I would like for you to get that. And he said, I would also like for you to stop over to the hospital. And he was being very nice and very patient. I didn't think it was a big deal. And I said, how soon do you want me to do this? And he finally looked me in the eye and he said, now. But then he scared me. He got my attention at that point. And I said, you mean like today? And he said, I mean like now. And he said, call Mary and have her drive you. I wondered if I was even going to live till I got to the hospital, the way, you know, how things kind of grow in your mind. And so I got over there, and I found out it was just AFib, and it could have been a lot worse. I didn't know that was coming. And I would venture to say, you who are sitting here tonight have probably gone through something within the last week or 2 weeks or month that you did not expect to have happen to you or someone you love. You see, we ask Jesus to pray and heal someone, and we expect an immediate response. Right now, when we say amen, let it be done. But that's not always in our best interest to work that way. And he will work in a way that will build our spirits, our faith, and he will strengthen us as we serve and follow him. So two words kind of sums up what I'm trying to say tonight. Trust Jesus. Trust him. I'm not talking about trusting him for what you see. Trust him for what you don't see. Because as Pastor Bob said this morning, God has got your back. You don't need to fear. If you give yourself completely into his control, you will be victorious no matter what. He works for his people who allow him to work on their behalf. Trust Jesus. What is your greatest difficulty or problem that you are facing right now? Trust Jesus. Mary has shared before about our son and his open heart surgery and so forth. I about lost it the day I walked into his room right after his surgery, the first time I saw him, and saw him laying there. He looked lifeless. And I stopped at the door and I looked. And up welled this emotion that started to overtake me. And the tears came to my eyes. And I had to turn around and walk out for a few moments. And in those few moments, the Lord reminded me that I had given my son to him when he was a baby. He was keeping his word. I needed to keep my word and trust him. I need to trust him with me, my wife, my family, with you, with this church, with the future. We don't know what's going to happen, but we do know one who does and can work all things to the glory of God and the betterment of his people. But we need to trust him. How can we trust him? We do not need to know what is ahead of us and how God is going to work. The people of the city expected a temporal act. They wanted God to be their servant and do for them what they wanted him to do. God's plan, however, is eternal, and he knows how to deal with our situations. He knows what is best for us and the way that is right for us to go. He wants all to come to salvation through Jesus Christ and enter into eternal life. But how can we secure this kind of a victory? By keeping in step with God's Holy Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verses 24 through 26 tells us, those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. If that is true within our lives, let's not go pick them off the cross and carry them again. They need to be dead to us. We need to be dead to them. Consider yourselves to be dead unto sin, but alive unto Jesus Christ. By keeping in step with the Spirit, we will live by the Spirit. And it says, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Let us not become conceited or provoke one another or be jealous of one another. Let's keep our eyes upon Jesus Christ above all else. And victory can and will be yours. As they say, keep your eyes on the prize. And the prize is Jesus. Because we have Him, we have an eternal home in heaven, and heaven is awaiting us. Let us accept the way of the Lord as He reveals it to us. Discard any preconceived ideas that you may have and just open yourself up fully to the Lord. As we were going home today, I told Mary, I said, this is the second Sunday in a row I felt like I needed to go home and change my message, because it was basically preached in the early service. But we never discussed what we were going to preach on. The Lord led him, and the Lord led me. Why we repeat it, I don't know. Maybe repetition is how we learn, which is true. Maybe there's some of us who are kind of hard-headed, like Mary. I didn't say that. I did not say that. Let us accept the way of the Lord as He reveals it to us. Get rid of preconceived ideas and just open your life to His leadership. Keep your eyes upon Jesus. Isaiah 26:3. And you will keep in perfect peace he whose thoughts and eyes and mind is stayed upon you. Are you looking at Jesus tonight? Man, this is the time of year we need to be looking at Him. Every time is, but especially now. And I'm going to try and do something, and I hope it will work out for us tonight. Walking on the road to Jerusalem, time to sacrifice had come again. My two small boys, they walked beside me on the road. The reason why they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. For there will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. And I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I cried, dear children, watch the Lamb. And when we reached the city, I knew that something must be wrong. There were no more, no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, crucify him. We tried to leave the city, but we could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, a part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy. The crowd gave him none. The second one was violent. He was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. And I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow. Running down the cross and falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back, and the crowd began to yell. In that moment I felt such agony. In that moment I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, you carry his cross! At first I tried to resist him, but his hand reached for his sword. And so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And I heard him say, Father, forgive them. Never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, "Father, please forgive us. The lamb ran away." "Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much we don't understand." So I took them in my arms, and we turned and faced the cross. And then I said, "Dear children, watch the Lamb." Father, thank you. With all that we have asked of you before, with all that you have done for us, and we forgot to acknowledge it, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for your Son, for your love, for your grace. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for your Spirit that keeps us where we ought to be. Thank you, Father, for this church and these people, and the victories that are yet to come. Thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.